Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. This is a tale of two builders. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Now, you guys have heard about the Tower of Pisa. Scientists have traveled to Pisa every year to measure the building's slow descent. They report that 179-foot tower, which was built in 1173, moves about 1/20 of an inch each year and is now 17 feet out of plumb. Recent renovations may have saved the 810-year-old tower and prevented it from collapsing. Quite significantly, the word Pisa means marshy land. That might be a little hint there to what the problem is. This passage we read today is about two builders who built two houses on two different types of foundations with two different results. The tale of two builders, Jesus teaches us that the foundation upon which we build the house of our lives is of the utmost importance. Now, we'll point out some things of this parable that show us why the foundation of your life matters. Many times we've been out witnessing, you probably have too, and they pray the prayer, they seem to be sincere, they go through the motions, there may be tears shed, they pray the prayer of salvation. They never follow up in baptism. They never come to church. Their speech doesn't change. Their habits don't change. So we've got to wonder, what kind of foundation are they building on? Now we'll consider the comparisons. This short parable appears to speak of two very different types of people. The two people Jesus pictures here have several important characteristics in common. Now let's point them out. Now, they both heard the words of Christ, didn't they? One man would build on the sand and one would build upon the rock. They heard the words of Christ. The two people in this parable both heard Jesus share his message of faith in repentance there in verse 24 and 26. Both people referenced in this parable knew the way of salvation. They both heard the gospel and each one had a reaction to it. Most people do when you witness to them and tell them about Christ, even from the sermon here tonight, people will hear it and they will react in different ways. And what they do determines what kind of foundation they will build upon. They both built houses. Each of these people built a house based on their understanding of what Jesus said. The house in this parable is a picture of a life. That is, each man built a life based on how they interpreted the message of Jesus. This means that both people believed the message to a certain point. They each applied the words of Jesus to their life as they saw fit. Now, isn't that what the world is doing today? They hear the words of Jesus. They hear the gospel preached. But they just hear what they want to hear. And they apply it to how it suits themselves. They don't want to follow Jesus' teachings the way that the Bible teaches. If they change it, as the devil did in the very beginning and still does today, it makes false doctrine. Now, both heard the words of Christ, both built houses, both built in the same location. Verses 27 describes a very severe storm. The storm affected both houses, so they must have been built in close proximity to one another. As we've seen, the storm affected both of them. So they must have been close to one another. We can tell that by the scripture. Now, they both built similar houses. Nothing is said about their houses being different. They use similar materials, most likely a similar design. As many houses today are similar, they look alike on the outside, a lot of vinyl, brick, so forth. Some are stucco and so on. But we can't see that foundation. We don't know what kind of corners were cut to fix that foundation. And a lot of you guys know it's built houses. The foundation is the most important part, isn't it? That's what holds it all up, isn't it? The picture is of people and how they respond differently to the gospel message. Just to clarify, the gospel is very simple. And here it is again. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received. How that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, 1 Corinthians 15, 3-4. And that is the message that must be believed in order for a person to be saved. That Jesus Christ came, he gave his life willingly on a cruel cross, that he died, was buried, and that he was resurrected, and now sits at the right hand of the throne of God. The Bible puts it this way, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Period. Belief. Abraham believed, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. He was justified 430 years before the law was given. This was Romans 10:9 here, thou shalt confess with thy mouth. Salvation is a simple as believing the gospel. Of course, you will notice that the Bible says in that verse, confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. We must confess this. We must believe it. Salvation involves faith in the gospel, but it also involves repentance of sin and a willingness to yield to the lordship and control of Jesus Christ in their lives, in our lives. We must say it. We must believe it. If we talk the talk, we must walk the walk. If we are living lives as a Christian, people should know it. They should see a difference. So people hear the message and they react to it in different ways. Regardless of how a person may react to it, they all build their lives based on what they think Jesus is saying. These people all build their houses in the same location. That is, they weather the same storms, work the same jobs, do the same things, go to the same churches, hear the same preaching, and live the same kind of lives. From the outside, you really can't tell much difference between the two hearers. True? We all come to church. We dress our Sunday go-to meeting clothes. We fix our hair, those of us that have it, and we do the best we can. We got our Bibles open. We're looking at the preacher. But what's in our hearts? Are we content? What kind of foundation are we building on? What kind of spiritual foundation are we building on? Are we hearing God's word? God's word said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. Are we following Christ? The young man, a co-worker of mine, he prayed the prayer, and I want to believe so badly that he is saved. That's between him and the Lord Jesus. But he's yet to follow up in baptism, and his first cousin also works with me, says that he's still partying and going on. What does that say? What kind of foundation is he building on? It's not too late for him or anyone else. For that matter, they can come to Jesus, they can make things right with the Lord, and they can be assured of what kind of foundation they're building on. If we're building a foundation on self and philosophies of this world, then the foundation is going to be that of sand. It won't weather the storm. Well, we considered the comparisons, let's consider the contrasts. While there are several similarities, there are some very major differences between these two types of people. Those differences are worth noting. One man built his house on the sand. One man built his house with little preparation. He found a spot for his house and began to build. Sand is unstable. ever-changing and moving. Sand offers no stability. Sand is not a good place to build a house. Sand can never provide a firm foundation, as we found out with the basement, right, guys? It's got a way of giving in, moving. It's not very stable. In this context, building on the sand speaks of people who hear the gospel, but instead of believing the gospel and coming to faith in Jesus, they believe they can build their lives on the shifting sands of human philosophy, wisdom, opinion, and religious achievement. They're driven by outward religious appearances and faith in themselves rather than faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. There are so many out there today who offer another way. Paul taught plainly on another Jesus. If it is not the Jesus that Paul talked about in the Bible, then it is false doctrine. Some teach that it is works. The Masonic Lodge teaches works. Jehovah's Witness teach works. You can be good enough. You can do so much. They hide behind a fake hate of good works and say that theirs is the right way. They won't offend people. I'd rather offend man than offend God. Fear not the man, the one that can kill the body, but fear the one who can kill the body and cast our soul into hell. This is God. But what did God do for us? He came in the flesh. He became flesh and blood. Just so He could be the Lamb for us, that perfect Lamb for us, that we could be reconciled unto Him. He knew we messed up. And He provided a way for us to be reconciled unto Him again. By choice. Even give us the freedom of choice to do this. As Jack said this morning, if you go to hell, it is on your own choice to go to hell. You have to walk over Jesus to go to hell. People who build on the sand hear the gospel and choose to save themselves. They hear the gospel and believe its general message, but they choose to follow God on their own terms. To them, His word is open to interpretation. If He commands them to do something, they will obey if they choose to. If they don't like it, they won't do it. What kind of foundation are these building on? They're building on self. They're building on the sand. Self-righteousness is not righteousness. We come to church for one reason only, and that is to hear God's word taught, God's word preached, and to glorify God. And in just coming to God's house as a witness for ourselves, to others, to many, that we have changed, that Jesus, that we're living for Jesus Christ today. That's why we come to church. We're dead to the old way now. The old man is gone. We're coming to church not for a social meeting, but to hear the blessed word of Jesus Christ. This holy word that we hold in our laps, that made us from the dust of the earth, that spoke everything into existence. We come to tell, to hear and tell others of that good news of Jesus Christ. But these people, they build the house of their lives on self-will, self-fulfillment, self-sufficiency, self-satisfaction, and self-righteousness. Theirs is a works-based religion that has the appearance of being right, but that lacks the power to save the soul. Paul describes that kind of person like this, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. 2 Timothy 3:5. From such, turn away. And as I said earlier, there are those who appear godly, who give millions of dollars to kids fighting cancer, people fighting cancer. That's a good thing. They're doing wonderful things. But what are they teaching? That if you do enough, that if you make it through enough degrees or steps, then you will get to that great architect in the sky. My God has a name, and it's Jesus Christ. Amen. All only steps or degrees I have to go through is confessing Him as my Savior. And I am saved by what His Word tells me. And if I give money or help people, I will give glory to Jesus Christ. If these people are serving Christ and doing these work to serve Christ, why do they not give Him the glory? They should be telling people about Jesus Christ. What a wonderful testimony. How many people could they reach through all the wonderful works that they do helping these people with cancer? That could be one to Christ also. Don't be fooled. Many false doctrines. People build on the sand because it is easy. It requires little effort, just a little change here and there. And they can fool themselves and everyone around them to thinking they're right with the Lord. A life built on the sand requires no commitment, no sacrifice, and no faith. People who build on the sand believe they can pray a prayer, sign a card, join a church, and all will be well. People who build on the sand can turn it on and off like flipping a switch. Like you preached, I believe it was last Sunday, if how many come to church, open their Bible? Is that the first time they open it since the previous Sunday? How many times through the week have we opened God's Word? Is it just something we do on Sundays? What kind of foundation are we building on? They can be in today and out tomorrow, and in again the next day. Sand builders ultimately have their faith in themselves. When God makes demands on sand builders and calls for total surrender to His will, they make excuses. Jesus encountered this very thing during His ministry. And it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto Him, Lord, I will follow Thee whithersoever Thou goest. And Jesus said unto him, Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man have not where to lay His head. And He said unto another, Follow Me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Jesus said unto him, Let the dead bury the dead. But go thou and preach the kingdom of God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow Thee, but let me first go bid them farewell which are at home at my house. Jesus said unto him, No man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Luke 9:57-62. People who build their lives on religion, self-righteousness, and false hope will not serve God. They will not sacrifice. They only walk the easy path. Set on their blessed assurance. Let the pastor pack it all. Sand builders like instant results, instant rewards, instant satisfaction, and instant pleasure. They come to church for a feeling. They want a feeling when they come to church. You're not preaching, you're teaching. I don't feel nothing. It makes me want to run back and just shake them real good. Let them feel something. Just opening God's Word and knowing what it took to put this in my lap. That makes me feel something. To know that God became flesh in Jesus Christ so that He could shed that life's blood for a wretch like me. If that don't make you feel something, nothing will. There are shallow people who love the heights but hate the depths. They're hot and then they're cold. They're in and then they're out. They're up and then they're down. These are people who build on the sand. One man built his house on the rock. The word rock refers to a large outcropping of rock, the bedrock. While one man built his house on the sand, the other dug deep. He dug until he reached the bedrock and built his house on the rock. The rock does not move. It is unchanging and stable. Rock offers a good foundation for a house. I work on the road department now, as y'all know. They worked on the Spicy Mountain here. They brought a drill rig in. But before they did, they test drilled to see if they could hit rock. Because they knew if they couldn't hit rock, it wouldn't hold. It had to be in something solid. And that's rock. Building on the rock speaks of people who hear the gospel and believe it to the point that they build their lives on it. The rock in these verses is identified as these words of mine. The rock is the is the gospel, the same rock mentioned in Matthew 16:16-18. Those verses say, He saith unto them, But whom say ye that I am? Jesus asked them, Whom say ye that I am? The people all around the world today are saying Jesus is this, Jesus is that. You are claiming to be a Christian. You are claiming to be a child of Christ. Who do you say Jesus is? He is Lord. I say He is Lord. He is my Lord and my Savior. And that is who I follow. That is who I say He is. And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And that passage, rock, refers to Peter's profession of faith in the words of Jesus. In other words, it refers to faith in the gospel. That's the rock Peter was building his foundation upon. Rock builders understand that Jesus alone has the power to save their soul. Rock builders hear His word and they conform their lives to it. They hear what the Bible says about Jesus, that He is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh to the Father but by me, as John 14:6. It is the only way, the only truth, the only life, like you said this morning. The only way. He is the only truth, the only life. They hear that message and they receive it with all their heart. They hear, For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. And friends, you'd be surprised at the people. This John 3:16, I consider one of the most famous verses in the Bible. And you'd be shocked at the people who do not know it. Even in our little town, do not know John 3:16. Sand builders. They hear, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Matthew 11:28. That message strikes them like a bolt of lightning. It comes into their hearts with absolute clarity. They hear the truth about Jesus and they believe it. They embrace it. They yield to it. The message changes their lives. Now these are the ones that build on a rock. They found Jesus worth digging for, worth digging deep and planting in their roots, that they can grow in Jesus Christ, and that their foundation will be solid and their house won't be moved. What God tells them to do in His word, they do. What God warns them not to do, they avoid. They pay any price, walk any path, and do anything the Lord tells them to do. The house built on the rock is built by someone who realizes that God deserves the best. They sacrifice, they work, they do anything to honor the Lord. They love Him, honor Him, and obey Him. The rock builder's obedience is to the word of God. It proves they love the Lord. John 14:15, rock builders hear the word of God, the gospel, and make it the foundation for their lives. How much we sacrifice, how much we give. We give to the offering. Now I'm just throwing this out there. You can take it for what it's worth. We give to the offering as we can. And nobody has to raise their hand or speak out, but did they go to the movies? Did they go to the movies? Did you eat out? We might be giving more to self than God. Now, I'm not saying don't do these things. I'm saying make sure your priorities are straight. By the way, this is how the redeemed know they are redeemed. And hereby we do know that we know Him if we keep His commandments. He that saith, I know Him, and keepeth not His commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth His word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in Him. He that saith he abideth in Him ought himself also to walk, even as He walked. 1 John 2:3-6. Again, people who claim to be Christian, talk the talk, are they walking the walk? Does your co-workers know you're a Christian? Do they curse and then say, oh, I'm sorry? It's not us they're apologizing to. It's not us because they're convicted. It's Jesus Christ in us. And if we are yielded to Jesus Christ and we are following Christ, if we are rock builders, they will see Christ in us. And Christ will be glorified. It is our duty as Christians to present God holy. And that's how people should see us. They should see Christ in us. They should know that we're rock builders. There's two people who construct vastly different lives based on how they hear and respond to the gospel. One house is built on a firm foundation of faith in the gospel, the Lord Jesus Christ. The other is built on shifting sand of religion, works, and self-righteousness. One of those houses describes the kind of life you are building right now. You are either a believer in the gospel and in Jesus, or you have a false religion and a false hope of salvation. I would just remind you that salvation comes only from knowing Jesus Christ as Savior. Church don't save. Paying tithes don't save. Shaking the preacher's hand don't save. It's Jesus Christ that saves. Hear again the clear message of the Bible. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Acts 4:12. No other name. Contrary to what the world believes, it is Jesus Christ that we must be dogmatic about. And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. Acts 16:31. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 3:11. Who or what is the foundation for your life? Who or what are you building on? Are you building your life on the solid rock of the gospel, or are you building your life on shifting sand? Now we've considered the comparisons. We've considered the contrasts. Too many actions, though, we know there's consequences. Let's consider now the consequences. The parable tells us that the rains came, the floods followed, and the winds of destruction blew. This image is not just about some storm in life. This is the image of judgment. In the end, both houses were subjected to a terrible storm of judgment. One house stood, and the other was totally destroyed. Great was the fall thereof. The house that was built on the sand could not face the withering judgment of God, and it's collapsed. Jesus said, and great was the fall of it. This means that the house was utterly destroyed. There was nothing left to show for the life lived within it. There was nothing left of hopes, dreams, plans, efforts, works, or anything. Everything was destroyed and swept away as if it had never existed. Jesus Christ is the only thing in our lives that is eternal. He makes us eternal. Our hopes and dreams and our little philosophies and the way this world thinks they have God scienced away is foolish. It's like building on the sand. The only thing solid in our lives from day to day is Jesus Christ. This is a picture of what will happen to every person who builds their life on anything but Jesus Christ and the gospel. Everything that they build will be destroyed. Utterly destroyed. There's coming a day of judgment. There's coming a day when every person will face God. People who are trusting religion or good works, some prayer they prayed, or some emotional experience they had, some profession they made, or anything else, will see the house they have built crumble and fall before the judgment of God. The person who builds their life on the sand will spend eternity in hell when they die. People, this isn't me. I'm just the messenger. This is what the Bible says. If we have our faith in self, or the world, or some motivational sermon, then hell was made for us. That will be our destination. If you do not have your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, the solid rock, one we sing about, then our homes, our spiritual homes, will be destroyed by the storm that will come. Notice the word therefore in verse 24. That word ties this parable to the verses that come before it. Matthew 7, 21 through 23 tells a tragic tale of some very religious people who built their lives on the sand. These people faced God with all their works and their self-righteous deeds, and they were cast out of His presence. God does not accept sinners into His heaven based on our good works or our religious efforts. God accepts sinners into His heavenly, into His heaven only when that sinner is in a faith relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. 1 John 5:12. Friends, it has to be Jesus Christ. As we see in those previous scriptures there, in verse 21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Verse 22, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Now, a lot of people, I've had people that I've witnessed to use this scripture to say, well, it don't matter if I go to church or not. They're just certain ones going to heaven because it says, Lord, Lord, there. You know, it don't matter if you cry, Lord, Lord, you may not go to heaven. And that's wrong. They're a victim to false doctrine. These are people who are, as the sermon says here, are depending on self. They've done these things for vainglory for self, not to bring glory to Jesus Christ. And if you read the whole chapter here, you'll see that. They're false prophets. Starting in verse 15 there, on through it starts talking, beware of false prophets there in verse 15. These are people who are self-righteous, who teach God's word in their way. And this is what the scripture here is warning us about. Many of people like that who will cry, Lord, Lord, will not enter into the kingdom of God, because God knows our hearts. His Spirit is inside us. When we confess Him as Lord and Savior, His Spirit, the Holy Spirit, comes to dwell in us, and He knows our hearts. As Paul said about the circumcision, it wasn't the circumcision in the flesh, but it was the circumcision of the heart that made the difference. What kind of foundation are we building upon? Where is our heart? The house that was built on the rock experienced the same storm. The rain, the flood, the wind beat upon the house. And we see that by Scripture. The same storm, it hit as well. The word beat means to strike, to batter. This house was battered, but it stood against a storm that was thrown against it. This house might have been shaken, but it did not fall. It stood on a firm foundation, and it weathered the storm because it was built on a rock. We must be built on a rock. Jesus Christ. Again, this house stood because it was built on the Word of God and the Gospel of grace. This house stood because the builder dug deep. We've got to dig in. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that we will not go through a fiery furnace in life, in our walk as a Christian. But it does say in Scripture that Jesus Christ will be right there with us. We have sisters in the church now who are fighting cancer. Some have passed away and lost the battle with cancer. But Jesus Christ was right with them, and He will be with us when we go through that storm. He will be with us, and we will stand because Jesus Christ is with us. We're on that rock. This house stood because the builder dug deep and built it on something greater than himself. This builder built his house on the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is finished. When He gave His last breath on the cross, He said, "It is finished." Not when He came up out of the water. It wasn't the waters of baptism that saved Him. If it was, He would have said, "It's finished." It was the blood, when He shed His life's blood, that you strike on the doorposts of your heart that he will pass over. When he sees us, he sees the blood of Christ. He sees that we are built on the rock. This builder believed the gospel. This builder understood that Jesus died for his sin, rose from the dead, and had the power to save anyone who would believe on him. This person built his life on Jesus, and he was accepted by God. That's how it works. You can join the church and still go to hell. You can be baptized and still go to hell. You can be a good person, at least in the eyes of others, and still go to hell. I say that continually because hell is a very real place. Heaven is a very real place. Well, how do you know, Mark? Because the Bible says so. You can build your house on religion and still go to hell. Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship with a living Savior. Amen. You can build your house on atheism, human wisdom, human philosophies, and anything else you can name, and you will still die and go to hell. But if you build your life on faith in Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection, your house will stand and you will be saved. The person who built his house on the sand did not intend for his house to fall. They don't today. They don't plan on going to hell today. They don't realize. A lot of them do. They should realize. You can't go anywhere here without passing a church. But to the world, we're just thorns. We're just in the way. But that's, as the sermon says, it's the world's way of thinking. They're building on the sand, and their house won't stand. He thought he was building a house that would stand against anything that came. He has confidence that his house will stand. He was wrong. His confidence is not in the Lord. It is in himself. His confidence is misplaced. There is nothing wrong with his house. There was nothing wrong with the materials. The problem with the house is the foundation. Cain had this problem. God had taught them about sacrifice. Abel was bringing what God wanted. But Cain was bringing on what he wanted God to see what he done. So it was a self-righteous sacrifice. And that's why it was not accepted. He knew what to do, but he chose not to do it. He made his choice. And it was the wrong choice. The lesson today, if you are building your house on anything but Jesus Christ and the gospel, it will fall. It might look sturdy. The materials might be all right. It might be pleasing to the eye. Everyone else might think the house is fine. But if it is built on the wrong foundation, it will fall. When it falls, you will be lost forever. And you will spend your eternity in the fires of hell. By the way, the one who sold this man the land upon which he built was the false prophets mentioned in verses 15 to 20. Beware of anyone who preaches any gospel other than the gospel of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. It says there in those previous scriptures to beware of wolves in sheep's clothing. Beware of anyone who says salvation is in anything but by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Well, the conclusion is, everybody in this room is building a spiritual house. Now, every day we attach boards, we drive nails, we add on rooms, or we try to improve that house in some way. Regardless of what you do to the house you're building, what matters the most is the foundation. Be sure you're building on Jesus Christ and the gospel. He is the solid rock. It is on him we depend on our salvation to keep us, for forgiveness, for everything. He is our all in all. Now this is a tale of two builders. And it gives us, it's just a little passage, but it's not many words, but it has much meaning. And how we can apply it to our lives. And I hope that you can apply this to your life. It touched my heart, and I hope it touches yours. Let's pray.